Hello, Facebook and Cosmoprof world. Today, we are live in Stamford, Connecticut, Conair headquarters. My name is Andy Mendoza, also known as Andy Authentic on social media. And we're going to show you guys how we use our BaBylissPRO tools to create awesome hair art and seamless blends using some tips that I'll share with you guys today. I have my model here with me today. His name's Fred. He has an awesome canvas, nice side profile. We have what's known as a faux hawk and a burst fade, which is a circular shape fade that I'll show you guys how to do. He also has that beautiful salt and pepper, that texture that's gonna show off this fade really nice. First tool I'm gonna show you guys is our BaBylissPRO flash effects. Now, before we use any tool, as professionals, first thing we want to do is disinfect our tools. And we're going to do that by using our BaBylissPRO all-in-one clipper spray. It disinfects, lubricates, cools, cleans, and prevents rust. So you want to turn on your clipper. You want to face it towards the spray with the stationary blade facing the spray, about a foot and a half away. Turn it around and spray once on the cutting blade. Now that is ready to go. It's lubricated and disinfected. We can go ahead and start this burst fade by what barbers like to call a line of demarcation. Now, a line of demarcation is a guide. It's the act of affixing a border. Now this border is going to tell us where this fade is going to start and where that zero line is going to begin graduating into this fade. So you go ahead and start this line with your teeth down, stationary blade up, and you mark that line of demarcation. This guide is going to tell us that this length is going to remain under this guide, and everything under this guide is going to be zero or bald down to the skin with the trimmer, and it can't go above it. That's why it's a guideline. So we always want to stretch the skin as we're cutting it.
Andy, can you discuss the importance of stretching the skin?
Stretching the skin is important for many reasons. One reason I like to show guys when I'm educating is, I'll show you guys on the other side, is when you don't stretch the skin, let's say for example with my trimmer off, I'm just going to show you guys how much the skin bounces up and down without stretching the skin. You see that? Imagine painting a canvas and somebody shaking the canvas on you while you're trying to create art. Now if you stretch the skin, what you do is you tighten up that skin. When you come in, you minimize how much that skin moves. So every stroke you make while you're fading or detailing, it's going to keep that skin in place so your movements are more accurate. And what you're trying to do is going to happen. So this is our initial line of demarcation. You determine your line of demarcation before you do your haircut. You step back, you look at the client, you consult the client and ask them where more or less he wants his fade to end or begin. How far up does he want his fade to go? How close the parietal ridge, or in this case on a faux hawk, we're going to go back towards the nape and then occipital bone. Okay, so that line is in. Now we're going to grab our BaBylissPRO FX880. This clipper here just so happens to have the fastest blade speed in the world. We're going to go ahead and turn it on, and I want you guys to hear this blade. Two sprays to the stationary blade and one to the cutting blade. So after our initial line of demarcation, we're going to control our taper adjustment. Now this FX880 uses a locking taper adjustment, which clicks every time you move your locking taper adjustment. We're gonna open it up all the way. This is called an open taper adjustment, also known as a half. Now what we did there was we moved our cutting blade away from our stationary blade, creating a distance. That distance translates into more hair on the scalp. So we go ahead and create our next guide. Remember, always keeping the skin stretched and taut. We're gonna go ahead and create a guide of about an inch or less. All the way around following this line of demarcation. This is an ascending guide, which means we're gonna rise in length as we go up. Now we created that guide. Now what I want you guys to do is use your taper adjustment and close it halfway. One, two, two out of four, that's halfway. And we're gonna compensate that within this line, this guideline. So we're gonna go up halfway on this guide. I'm gonna divide it into two the same way we divided our taper adjustment. Now we're gonna close our taper adjustment all the way. I'm gonna go ahead and try to blend away the remainder of this line that we created with our trimmer. If we see any dark spots or imperfections, what we do is we grab our tool that we use to make this line of demarcation and we blend it away with that. So this is important, guys. If you guys are afraid to create that harsh, bold line to begin a fade, this is what we're doing here. We're fading away the fear. We're doing that by understanding how we can use our tools to help us create these transitions.
Andy, a question came in. Sherry wanted to know what clipper you're using right now.
This is the BaBylissPRO FX880. It has a Ferrari engine. It is a corded clipper. Super long cord. You can go to the store and come back with this cord. So we're going to grab our flash effects. And any line that we see, any line, any weight or imperfections, or density, little clumps of hair there together. You guys know every now and then you'll see little dark spots. What we're going to do is we're going to use the corner of the blade. Call this corner blending. Stretch the skin, isolate the imperfection with the corner of your blade, and go ahead and tackle it. We don't want to place the tool flat against the head or the scalp, because then we'll create other imperfections. We just want to isolate what we want to work on. This technique is called corner blending.
Andy, Joyce wanted to know why you're wearing gloves during this cut. Is this something you always do?
There's a few reasons. I would say there's three reasons. Reason number one is because we want to be clean. Now, what we do is we'll remove these temporary gloves in between each client, and it's almost like washing your hands. I don't know how many of you guys can wash your hands 30 times a day or 20 times a day, but it's not the best thing for your knuckles. So this is just a way to keep your hands clean and keep your client's head clean as well by using disposable gloves, a new pair for every client. Number two is a barber and stylist's worst nightmare, and that's hair splinters. Throw up some thumbs if you guys know about hair splinters. Nobody likes those. Probably the last reason. Looks awesome. Just look awesome. Alright guys, so we're back on the other side. If you guys are wondering why I'm going from one side of his head to the other without finishing the fade on one side, is because I want to use my tool for every task that I'm performing. I don't want to put the tool down until I've performed that task completely on the head. Now, if I can explain that a different way, is don't stop using the trimmer until you're done doing what the trimmer does completely on one side. You want to minimize how many times you pick up and put down a tool. That's called being efficient. So I created my first guideline with a half. Close my taper adjustment halfway. And I'm going to slide down halfway on that guide I created with the open taper adjustment. Every stroke you make, you want to keep the skin taut. And you want to use what we call a C-scoop motion. That's when you come in with the clipper and you flick away like a C. Now that we did that, we're going to go ahead and close our taper adjustment fully and tackle the remainder of this guideline. Some hair types and textures, at this point, you will not see an imperfection or a weight line. But on this hair type, we do see that we need to come back in with the trimmer and make this a little more seamless. So I'll grab my flash effects, turn it to the side, and start point cutting. We're only cutting what we feel is sticking out, where the imperfection is, where the weight is. So now we've created a transition from trimmer length, which is a zero, up to about a half. Now what we'll do is we'll use our attachment comb to blend into the next length. I've attached a number one guard on the FX880. That's an eighth of an inch. I like to approach the hair with my open taper adjustment. Reason being is you can always cut more hair off, but we can't put it on once it's off. What I'm doing here is I'm listening to the clipper, how much hair is it cutting? And I'm looking for a change in contrast. So when someone asks you, how high do you go with a specific guard? There's no real answer to that. What you have to do is just look at your client, determine an attractive and a suitable height for a fade, and you want to use your judgment as you go up with these guards and you're cutting hair. You tell yourself, are you going up too high? Is this suitable? That was an open taper adjustment. Now we're going to close it. I'm going to come in just under wherever we were at. And you're looking for a change in contrast. Trying to create a seamless transition in this blend.
Andy, you're getting a lot of thumbs up coming in. Everybody's liking what you're doing.
Yeah. Appreciate you guys. Ask away. We're here to help you guys out. This is what we love to do.
Erica Beth has a question. Andy, do you have a preference to corded versus cordless clippers?
My preference is biased because I travel. So, you know, obviously these cords take up a lot of space and I'm not sure if you guys want to show them my little case, but once you put some products in there and a blow dryer and a few clippers, it just got real small. So yeah, I do have a preference to cordless, only because of space. This machine here, if I were at the shop, this is a workhorse. This thing stops for nothing. It does not warm up. And the battery, no battery life means no charging. It's just super powerful. That Ferrari motor is unstoppable. So guys, I noticed a little weight line. So I went and I popped on my 0.5 guard. This is a 1/16th of an inch length. And again, I'm just looking for a change in contrast. I'm nitpicking this blend, trying to make it flawless. Speaking of a flawless blend, do we, as barbers and stylists, need to learn how to make a perfect fade to make money and be successful? Although I've been noted for having, you know, clean work, as a business owner and as a person that, you know, I would say that I'm doing all right in the industry, I understand that a perfect fade isn't everything you need. You guys definitely want to watch and learn how to do a seamless blend. But also we all have to remember that in every town all across America, there's a barber down the street from you and I that's doing perfect fades for $10. So how do we compete with that? How do we compete with a stylist that has mastered the technical part of what we do and is doing it for cheap? Now we do that by being punctual. We do that by being informative. We do that by being professional. And we do that by offering our clients services that, you know, places, other places don't. So even though you guys want to focus on learning how to create nice blends, don't rely on them. Rely on your service and your professionalism. Those are the things that get you successful.
Erica Beth said, preach, Andy, preach.
Hallelujah. Mm-hmm.
And it looks like Dee Santiago, Andy for president.
One day. So how's that looking so far? Decent? Let's pick at it some more. Popped on a half guard again. I'm just looking for any imperfections. Finish up this blend. What I'll do is I'll grab a number 2 guard. I don't use more than a 2 guard, guys. This is an attachment comb. This creates length. Creates a distance from the cutting blade to the scalp. It's an attachment comb. This is a comb. Basically, every length that you can create with attachment combs, you should be able to do with a comb. Clipper over comb technique. You pick the hair, isolate it, create the path you want the clipper to go on, and you can create elevation just using your comb. You don't need an attachment comb. Don't rely on guards. One thing I hate to see when guys educate or teach someone how to cut hair is it's all number talk. 2, 2.5, 3.5, you go down to 4, 2, 1.5, and 4. It's not necessary, guys. If you have a comb, that's all you need. Especially this BaBylissPRO comb. We just dropped them. Comes in a set of 3. You know, they, besides the fact that they look awesome and they have this nice, like, rubbery type of texture, they're not slippery or that hard, shiny comb. They're super flexible. Now, the reason why that's cool, because now we can go ahead and scoop hair on a client, flex that comb out, and that's how we create transition. We can go from short to long by creating a distance in the head by flexing that comb. Show you guys how that works. So we go ahead and get a little bit of transition going here. This is all comb. We're going to follow this client's profile, which is straight up. This is a faux hawk. So when you look at this client dead on, what we have to remember is our profile is going straight up. Every stroke we made was following this profile.
Andy, I know you're not working with one of your trimmers right now, but Joyce wanted to know, I'm in need of new trimmers or edgers. What are you using for detail?
For detail, I like to use my Flash Effects. Good battery life, 2 speeds. You have your low, which is good for kids around the ear, low buzz. And you have your high for a coarse beard or some sharp lines. Another reason why I like it is because this blade pops right off. You can go ahead and clean that just with a brush and a spray. As soon as you're done, you pop it right back on. Small, fits good in the hand. That's rule number 1 whenever you're choosing any tool. Just put it in your hand. How do you like it? Do you feel like you can use it for 12 hours a day, 10 hours, 8 hours? That's rule number 1. Then after that, you know, if it cuts to your liking and it has a good battery life or whatever else you like to consider. But yeah, the Flash Effects, it's good enough for me. It's sharp, looks good, and it lasts a while. Good battery life. We do have a line that we're going to put in Fred's hair. I'm going to show you guys how to do that. First thing you want to do is you want to brush your hair. You want it to be in the direction where you want your line to end up. Now there's two steps to creating a sharp line. Some people make the mistake of making the line and then just going ahead and leaving it alone. Now remember, there's hair that is coming down and we want to cut that hair. But we also want to flip the trimmer upside down and chase that line and cut those follicles that were exposed by cutting that top half of the line with the hairs that were growing down. So let's go ahead and perform that. This doesn't have to look extremely sharp because I am going to touch it up with a straight edge razor. When you create a line, what you're doing is you're planning how this line is going to look when there's what hair is going to be left over, what's left behind. You're not focusing on the skin, you're focusing on what hair is left behind. That makes sense. Flip it around. Now you see these hairs that were exposed. These are the ones we're touching now. This is how you create a sharp line that looks sharp on both ends of the line, right? Because there's hair on both sides of this line. So don't just cut hair on one side of the line. Make it sharp on both sides. One thing I like to do when I do lines is I like to start them a little wider. Then I like them to fade away real thin. Just gives the line a little more attitude, a little character. And I think it looks better. I'm gonna come in and shape up this temple area right on the lower recession. Up to the high recession, you want to hold the hair up. Then you want to brush down any baby hairs and keep it as natural as possible. Wherever you aim your stationary blade, that's where the sharp line is going to be. So in other words, you don't want to shape this area dragging this way or vice versa. You want to point your stationary blade, which is the blade that does not move, so wherever you want your sharp line to be. Now I'm just looking for little things that I can make look a little better. Any imperfections. All right. Let's go ahead and give them a line on the nape. Starting from that hairline. I'm going to brush the hair. I'm going to go ahead and create that line. Once we're satisfied with the first half of that line and how it looks, is it sharp? Does it look good? Go ahead and turn our trimmer around. You can stretch the skin. You want to create that second half of the line. Again, I'm going to go from thicker to thin. Now we're going to let it finish the hairline. Try to go as natural as possible. Now we're going to move on to the next side. Finish this fade, this transition, and also shape it up. I'm going to go ahead and grab my one guard. Now we're moving in real time. Open taper adjustment. We're looking for a change in contrast and we're listening to see how much hair we're cutting. Stretch the skin. After I do my open taper adjustment, go ahead and close that taper adjustment halfway. Start using my C-scoop motion to change the contrast just under that line I created. If I'm satisfied with that, I'll close my taper adjustment all the way. and go just under where I was just at. If I feel like I still see a line, I'll go down a guard. So that means we're going to put on our 0.5. I'm going to go in taper adjustment closed, because I already know what length this is and I have a feel for it. And you guys will too once you do this over and over again. What all of you guys want to do is take pieces from each stylist you ever watch, every barber you ever come across, take his best and put it in your formula. By formula, I mean something that you guys do every time you fade. You should follow your formula, follow the same steps, what works for you. That's the only way you're going to have consistent results and improve your quality. Now I feel like there's a little weight line there, so I'm going to go in taper adjustment open. Stretch the skin. Now I'm listening to see how much hair I'm cutting, how that contrast is changing, and how this blend is looking. Picking at imperfections. Close that taper adjustment slightly, two notches. I'm just chasing dark spots. This is all at this length of hair. We're really not talking length anymore. This is shades. Even down to the smallest follicle is like, that's what we're cutting. Just the hair that's exposed after you cut it out of the skin, whatever's out of the follicle, that creates a shade in this transition.
Andy, people are wondering about the brush that you're using. What kind of brush is it, and do you use a different brush for every hair type?
This brush is basically a nail brush, any small brush, baby brush. You can get a small boar's hair bristle brush. Just anything that will have ability to not only brush the hair into place, but also clean the skin. Clean off any hair that's on the skin. That's something that you don't want in your fade, especially a bald fade like we gave Fred today. You don't want any hair that's just hanging around that's not really attached to him anymore. Because you don't want to cut, make new cuts and adjust your fade based on hair that's not even on his scalp anymore. So I'll just use anything that I can wipe away hair with. You can do that with a fine tooth comb as well. So I'm going to come in with this comb, this clipper comb by BaBylissPRO. We're going to go ahead and create that profile by using this comb as our guide. Usually taper adjustment close would be the best way to do this. Make sure you pick that hair out to its full length. Or you can even freestyle. That's the advantage of having good tools that are sharp. I can go ahead and freestyle and just chisel this blend, chisel this hair into the shape I want. My blade is so sharp that I'm not pushing the hair. It's just cutting, swiping through, and whatever shape I want it to be, that's what it's looking like. Everyone does it different. You guys just have to find out what's your way. What's gonna work for you? So now we're just touching little imperfections, trying to make this transition look as smooth as possible. It's not a bad idea to tilt your client in different directions just to get different angles. Now we're ready for our flash effects. So go ahead and square them up and finish this shape up on the nape line. Again, we want to brush his hair. Try to keep it as natural as possible. Yeah, we want things to look fancy and sharp, but no, we don't want an inch of regrowth, guys. So let's try to keep this as natural as possible. Move on to his lower recession. follow that hairline where it is naturally. Want to hold his hair back, brush down any baby hairs. Again, keep it as natural as possible. Unless the client wants his hairline to be super duper square and push back, but Fred is actually a client of mine and a friend, and I know he does not want his hairline to be an inch away from where it grows. So there we have a nice little burst fade mohawk. Two lines. We're going to come back later and hit that with a razor, make it a little sharper, those lines. Right now what I'm going to do is I'm going to teach you guys how to do a blended beard. Now my first step to this is I grab my trimmer and I rake down on the beard, pulling away using a reverse C-scoop motion. I'm raking down and I'm creating that transition. After you do that, you go ahead and go against the grain from where you started. That's two ways to cut a hair stubble. You want to go with the grain, it leaves a darker hair stubble. You go against the grain, and now you've really, really gotten down to the skin. We'll grab our FX 880 open taper adjustment. I'm not resting this clipper on his skin. I'm just isolating the hairs that I feel like are a little darker, and I'm almost hovering over them. It's the advantage of having a sharp blade. I'm angling this clipper at this angle, and I'm using the distance of the teeth to the cutting blade as almost a guide. And I just want to pick at this blade to create that transition. Once I'm happy with the transition, now I'm going to close my cutting blade, my taper adjustment. I'm going to angle his head, and I'm going to go with the grain. Floating above it. Very slightly. You don't want to rely on guards to cut curly hair. Reason being is guards are going to push those curls. They're going to cut them at a length that they're not really at. And when you release those curls, are going to go back to their original position. It's going to look completely different than it did while you were cutting it. We're going to grab our effect, our flash effects. We're going to go with the stationary blade pointing to the line that we want to make sharp. We want to stretch the ear so we create space, and we want to push into this beard, following the jawline, keeping it as natural as possible. Just take off just a little bit of hair under the beard because we're trying to let this beard grow. Stationary blade facing down, and we're going to go ahead and create that sharp line on the cheek. I'm not going down too far because, again, I'm going to come back in here with a razor blade, a straight edge, and make it super sharp.
Andy, you're getting a lot of positive comments. People are saying this looks great. Your fellow barbers on here, Harry Houdini's, his beautiful angle.
Yeah. Appreciate you guys.
And Monk says groovy.
Sweet. We're doing it for you guys. So as long as you guys are loving it, we're happy. So now I'm going to go ahead and put some shave gel. Any clear shave gel, guys? Just take your time when you're shaving. Put that in the hair parts and on the hairline and on the beard lineup. This is a new blade that we put on the razor before we started. Keep the skin taut and always move up and down. Stretch the skin away from the direction you're going to move the blade. If the blade is going to go down, we're going to stretch the skin up. The blade is going to go horizontally towards his hairline. We're going to stretch the skin away from the hairline.
What we're doing is we're following these hair follicles that we see along the bottom half of this line. We're just tapping them. Trying to make that line a little sharper.
Andy Austin says, Andy, you are great, bro. I hope I have the honor of working with you someday.
Yeah, let's do it, man. Likewise. So we're stretching his skin. Now, before I do the cheek, I like to dry it up a little. I don't want this to be too saturated while I'm working on it. Stretch the skin. Go down into the beard. Probably the quietest room I've ever cut in. Hope you guys are enjoying this fade and this shape up. So now I'm just navigating and I'm looking for any little hair that I can take off. Let's go to the back and show you guys how I'll make this line sharp as well.
Tina really appreciates the detail that you're putting into this cut.
Thank you, Tina. Appreciate you for tuning in. Appreciate everybody for tuning in. While you guys are here, I'd like to remind you guys, if you guys don't already, go ahead and follow BaBylissPRO on Instagram, Babyliss for Barbers on Instagram, follow CosmoPRO on Instagram, and if you still have time after that, hey, follow Andy Authentic on Instagram. I'd appreciate it.
Andy, where's your barbershop located in the name?
I have a barbershop in Bristol, Connecticut. It's called a Fresh Factory Barbershop. And I have a talented team of professionals who are passionate about what they do. Sorry, that looks good. What I like to do, guys, to make a hairline really stand out is I'll go ahead and line it up with an eyeliner, just any generic brand eyeliner, just slightly lighter than your client. What that's going to do is create a contrast. It's going to highlight the work we made. It's going to make sure everything is lined up nice. And I'll show you guys why. When you go ahead and trace this line up with a eyeliner, what you're doing is any hairs that are out of place are now going to stand out. Because the black hair on top of this light line is going to stick out like a sore thumb. So that's the most important reason why we use this lineup. Well, I call them lineup pencils, but they're actually eyeliners. But after we cut them, you'll guys see that it creates a nice little contrast, which I believe looks pretty cool. I'm even gonna put it on the design I created. That's really going to expose any hairs that are out of place. On the back. You guys feel free to do this at the shop. It's a good way to make sure all your lines are at the right place. No hair is out of position. And also make your work look a little cool. It almost pops out. It's like it's going to glow. So the hairs that were out of place, what I'm doing now is I'm going ahead and I'm coming in and I'm trimming them. With this trimmer, the flash effects, stretch the skin.
Andy, can you just tell Stephanie what you used for the outline? She says, is it a chalk marker?
Nope, it's just an eyeliner, any generic eyeliner. Just make sure it's a little lighter so it'll actually stand out. Again, what it does is it exposes any hair that's out of place. I just saw one there. See one right there. See one right there. And a couple on the corner of this shape up. That looks a little sharper. Come around the back. Using the corner of this trimmer to create these shapes, and also go ahead and pick out any hairs that are out of place. So there you go, guys, a little, see if we can get some good lighting.
Tina says Fred looks very relaxed.
Fred looks relaxed. We do this with Fred every 2 weeks, every week.
Yes.
So we're going to go ahead and blend in the other side of the beard. Going to grab our trimmer and use our C-scoop motion reversed. We're raking down and away. Now after we go ahead and create that transition, we're going to come against the grain and blend in the top of that little guide we made here.
Hey, we had some questions coming in. Zoe Mendoza wants to know, do you have a favorite haircut you like to do?
It depends on what are the times like, you know. Right now, these times, I think this haircut stands out, looks pretty cool, but it just depends on what time is it, you know. There was a time I actually enjoyed doing the comb over with a hard part. Now it's like I cringe when they ask me for it, you know. So it depends on whether the styles are. I think as barbers and stylists, it's important for us to always stay up with trends and follow up what's hot, what's not. So right now, I would say I enjoy being challenged. Fred has salt and pepper hair. He has very curly hair. He has a style that has a specific shape that I need to follow. To me, I consider that a challenge, and I enjoy it. So I enjoy a challenge right now, more than a specific style. And the challenge could come from any client, a young client with unique hair, or an older client with completely gray hair and wants volume or something, you know? Whatever challenges me, that's what I like.
Andy, Diane wanted to know if you have any tips or suggestions. She wants to know, can you talk about using or not using clippers or razors on skin bumps or acne or any issues on your client's head?
Absolutely. That's another reason why that's another way that we can elevate our value, guys. It's by educating our clients, teaching them how to take care of their hair and skin after their haircut. Ingrown hairs and bumps, those are common. There's ways that as barbers we can help eliminate those by not shaving against the grain on the neck or below the jaw. There's a lot of things that we can do to aid our clients, but it's also us informing them of what they can do for their aftercare. I'm only as good as, you know, my client's canvas allows me to look when I'm doing my work, right? If I don't have cool people to cut and cool heads, my pictures might not be all that great. So It's important for us to work with our clients and inform them how to take care of their skin so they can look their best and make us look better. As they walk around, they're our walking canvas, you know. Nobody's going to approach a client that doesn't have something appealing on their face or, you know, head because of what a barber did. So, yeah. But to give you some advice on how to stay away from innies and bumps, try not to shave on the neck, front and back. Or if you are, just don't do it, you know, too harshly. There's a adjustment of pressure here. Go ahead and put some shave gel on there. And nothing against the grain, guys. That's about it.
Andy D said, wants to know, would you say that cutting a person's hair that has braids in it is hard to cut?
We're not cutting braids off. So I would say there's a small challenge in staying away from the braids. There's a few things that you guys can do. Not obviously, but for the most part, usually someone who has nice tight braids, they would have curly hair. If they don't, that's cool too. What you want to control is the stragglers around or on the braid even. You just aiming to clean those up. Another thing that you can do is comb and brush the hair in a specific direction and hairspray it. You want to zap it with some hairspray. I like to use, where is my hairspray? Biomega Freeze, baby. This is Biomega Freeze, baby. What you want to do is you want to spray hair. It's good to spray hair down and freeze it. Freeze it in place. That's how you control it. So that's a good way to cut braids, especially around the hairline.
Andy, Ashley wants to know, would you recommend this type of haircut on a boy with thick, stick straight, and fine hair? She loves it.
You can do a burst fade and a faux hawk on straight hair. It's just going to be different. It's going to be a different approach, different dynamics. There's different stuff going on. Fred obviously has hair that can be brushed in a direction, cut in that direction, and it'll stay there, showing off the shape I created. Someone with thick, straight hair, you might run into weight falling. So it's going to look different. The haircut is going to look different. I think it's possible. I think a haircut that is done the right way with the proper layering and the proper cutting will enable you to later style it in a shape that you want. This particular haircut on a client with straight hair will require some styling, some blow drying, and directing of hair. But yeah, it's possible for sure.
Joni wanted to know, can you give a tip on a quick cleanup and sanitation between clipper cuts? I find it so messy.
What I like to do is just basically brush my stuff down. I'll show you guys how to clean this flash effects. You wanna brush that has pretty firm bristles. You don't use this brush on clients. This is only for clippers. So you want to have a brush that's just to clean your clippers. You want to brush it. Brush the cutting blade. Brush the stationary blade. Now again, two sprays on the stationary blade. Turn it on. One spray on the cutting blade. And with the flash effects, you can also pop it out. Go ahead and disinfect in there. Why not? Pop that back on. It's pretty quick. What was that? Maybe 12 seconds per client. Okay. So we lined up our model. And I'm going to finalize this. Just by lining up that shape up with the eyeliner. Just to give it that pretty cool pop. make sure no hairs are out of place. This is a good way for us to also ensure our client that we are within the hairline limits without having to go insanely into the density of his hairline. Now, that's something that a lot of people do when they begin doing haircuts. They chase that sharp edge by going into the density of the hairline too far. So we're picking out any hairs that are out of place. Stretch the skin.
Andy, we're coming into the last 10 minutes of the broadcast. Is there a way that you can just kind of recap for people that might be tuning in at the end what you did with Fred's hair?
Okay, guys. So while I finish up this beard real quick, we'll go ahead and run down everything we did. And I believe we'll have enough time to just touch up his beard just a little. Let's go ahead and finish up the back of his hairline. So, our model today got a burst fade. Burst fade, full hawk, or mohawk. What we did was we started with our initial guideline, a line of demarcation. It was a zero, done with the flash effects. Everything below that guideline remained a zero. We came in with our FX 880. And we made a half guide, blended that in, popped on our number one, went a little higher. Then played with the half guard to blend in any imperfections. We used our BaBylissPRO comb to guide us around this transition, exposing any hairs that were out of place, like this one here. And we created that shape. That straight up and down shape. We then went and shape Fred up by using our flash effects. We followed the hairline. We stayed in his guide, in his hair, natural hairline. We created a part using our stationary blade in both directions. We created a transition in his beard using our trimmer, raking away, doing a C-scoop motion, and then using our FX 880 to create a transition using our locking taper adjustment. And now we're going to go ahead and finish his mustache. Brush down, line up just above his lip, not too much. Stretch your lip down. Spray a little water in his beard for some hydration before I come in. My Rapido blow dryer. This Rapido has a body that does not get hot no matter how hot the blow dryer is. We're going to gently use this round brush to just stretch his beard slightly. I'm on low heat low air. After that, like I was telling you guys earlier, a trick to cutting curly hair is spraying it with a little hairspray to keep it in place. Cover your client, zap a little of that freeze baby in there, just a little. Come back, grab my rapido, and cool. And I'm gonna press down on the curls just a little bit. I wanna lay this beard down as much as possible so I can cut the least possible. So basically I dressed it before I cut it. And I blow dried it to a long, to its real length. Because if the curls are tight to his face, you can't really see how long this beard is. But now that we blew it out a little, you can see the real length. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and look for any hairs that are out of place. We're using the tone of his skin to expose anything that's out of place. That's what we're doing. We only want to cut the extremities, whatever's completely out of place. You don't want to cut into the body of this beard. So after I get his shape facing him, that jawline shape, what I'll do is I'll come over to his side. Now I'm looking to see what imperfections or hairs out of place I can see. See, looking at him from the side, I'll go ahead and follow that. This is a freehand cutting technique. It's called beard sculpting. Again, super important to have a sharp clipper, sharp blade. You don't want to push the hairs, you just want to go right through them. And BaBylissPRO honestly is second to none when it comes to clipper and blade technology. So basically that's how we go ahead, chisel up a beard. Again, the tools I use today are the BaBylissPRO FX880, our flash effects, two speeds, light, lithium ion battery, feels good in the hand. FX880, I mean the fastest blade speed in the world, Ferrari motor, doesn't get hot, it's awesome. Locking taper adjustment. And there you have it, guys. Hope you guys enjoyed it. We're live from Stamford, Connecticut. Conair, home of BaBylissPRO, Rusk, Aquage, you name it, we got it. Hope you guys enjoyed it. Remember to visit your local Cosmo Pro for all of your latest tools and products made by Aquage, Rusk, and whatever, you know. We appreciate you guys for joining us. I hope you liked it. Send me a message if you need any help with your haircut or things you want to do. And I'll gladly respond. This is Andy Authentic, signing out.